This episode's made possible by Planful.
Hello, on today's show, we'll be featuring the FP&A insights and commentary of three finance leaders, including CFO Tony Corcia-Grossa of Pinstripes, CFO Karen Williams of American Express Global Business Travel, and CFO Robert Cornella of RNDC. This is Jack Sweeney, your co-host, along with performance management guru, Brett Knowles, who will serve as our resident thought leader as we together seek to highlight the takeaways from our distinguished group of planning aces. We'll begin after this.
Hi, I'm Rowan Tonkin, Chief Marketing Officer at Planful, and we're a proud sponsor of CFO Thought Leader. At Planful, we're empowering teams just like yours to drive peak financial performance in every corner of your business. What sets Planful apart? We have purpose-built applications for every department, from FP&A to accounting, marketing to HR, all with built-in financial intelligence. This means we can get you up and running within weeks, and it requires minimal IT involvement. So you can rapidly and seamlessly engage everyone across the business in your key financial processes. Best of all, you can't outgrow us. We take the pain of growing away with an unmatched ability to scale with you. You have an endless runway with Planful. See why over 1,300 customers around the world choose Planful as their flexible, user-friendly, end-to-end financial performance management platform. Go to planful.com and see how you can make financial performance a team sport in your business.
Hi, it's Jack, and I'm here with Brett Knowles. Brett, I just want to mention this episode's three planning aces really have interesting backgrounds, each of them. And two of them have really more of a global resume. But each came up through the ranks in a different fashion. Interesting roles from one rung to the next, more senior responsibilities. And finally, they enter the CFO office.
You know, what's interesting is Robert has that pedigree you just described. Like, he's got this incredible Cambridge background and so on. He's, you know, been in all those really interesting, important jobs and so on. And so I thought it was interesting as we started listening to Karen, because she's also had that sort of global responsibility, you know, big corporate, but her undergrad is in politics.
You're right. And you know what? I didn't pick up on it in part, and we haven't published her episode yet of CFO Thought Leader. It'll be coming out this coming Sunday. It'll be episode 2014. But Karen Williams, who is CFO of American Express Global Business Travel. Now, she becomes an entrepreneur right out of school. It was something she said she always wanted to do. And then what's interesting, she takes another surprise turn and she goes to work for the Mars family, the confectionery company. Just some early chapters that she had that just didn't necessarily conform to early year chapters for CFOs.
And I think there's an important lesson there that, you know, you can reach these pretty high illustrious corporate heights without necessarily having an accounting degree per se. Again, Karen's a good example where if you took a snapshot of her after undergrad with a politics degree, you'd not project that she'd be where she is now. And she's had some, you know, pretty interesting positions that have taken her to where she is. It's not an accident that she's there. She's earned the right to be there. But with that small data set of what degree you took, you wouldn't project this outcome.
Since we're focused on the career path for the moment, I should mention that Tony Corcia-Grossa, who is today's CFO of Pinstripes, we'll be hearing from, he had worked for General Electric for half a dozen years or so. While Robert Cornella worked for Coca-Cola for like 17 years. And I should also mention that Cornella It wasn't Cambridge. It was Oxford, by the way. He got a degree, a master's in corporate finance from Oxford. And Karen, of course, she had a nearly a 10-year stint at American Express, which she exits and she joins a travel company, an interesting travel company. Again, we haven't featured her episode yet, so please do tune in for that. But what else? As far as what they have in common, they each have interesting backgrounds, no question. But what else? What's the common thread here for us to discuss?
They certainly share a curiosity about data and looking for new and different ways to measure how the organization is performing. And they all formed their models about what that search and that journey looks like. And so I think that's the key learning for all of us is never be complacent with the data that you currently have or even the key metrics you're currently using. You know, be constantly curious.
That's it. I think you nailed it. That would be the thread. And we're going to tee up our first planning ace, who's Tony Corchagrossa, CFO of Pinstripes. Now, for those, Tony's episode's available if you want to find out more about Pinstripes, which is an entertainment company. It's at one of Tony's entrepreneurial chapter or the entrepreneurial chapter in his career, I would say. At the same time, he's about to talk about Medline, which is a company he joins as a finance director and advances into the CFO of North America role. But anyway, looking back, he reflected on this particular moment, this chapter, I thought would be great for planning aces. Again, Tony was at GE for about a half dozen years before he joins Medline as a finance director. Here he is, Tony Corchagrossa.
You know, Medline presented a lot more opportunities to kind of be at the front and center, right on the front lines of particularly M&A. That's where I spent a lot of my time. You know, Medline became very acquisitive when I joined. And you weren't part of some big team. You weren't a cog in a wheel, which can happen at big companies for good reasons. They have to be structured that way. At Medline, it was, you know, me and a couple others and we were very much, you know, all over the entire process, whether it was, you know, due diligence or, you know, negotiating the purchase agreement to dealing with, you know, the lawyers and bankers, et cetera. And, you know, got a front, you know, front row seat to that, which was great. And I don't think I would have gotten if I had stayed in an environment like GE. So, and, you know, my strategic moment was when I was sitting with one of the commercial leaders. And Medline, to this day, continues to be a very commercially driven organization. So they're at the forefront, and they kind of run the business for the most part. I sat with him, and we were talking about just ways to get more involved. And inevitably, it always come back to like expense management and reporting. And then I noticed that he was recruiting for an analyst on his own. And I said, yeah, I think we can help you with that. We could get a better qualified candidate. They'll have access to more data and tools. And you don't need to worry about keeping them happy because I got, you know, 30 other jobs that they'll be able to tap into in their career. And so you don't need to worry about organizational management. And that's when the commercial finance function was born at Medline. And what it realized to me is, hey, if you want to get a ton of support from the leaders of a business and you want to be a real partner, you need to solve, you know, the problems of your business partners. And in that case, it was people and functionality. And it wasn't just some report or data or expense management. We were literally handling an organizational issue for that leader and an important leader in the business. So, you know, that's where I from there on out, that's, I always keep that at the forefront of my mind about, yeah, if you keep that mentality as a finance leader, you'll be a great business partner.
Well, I thought what was interesting about Tony, in addition to, as you just pointed out, his career path, is that, you know, he made the interesting point that there are benefits to being in a small business because you get to see every part of the business. And that I think is super important because although we divide organizations up into departments, they really are, we call it organization, no different than organism. Like as, you know, as a human, as an organism, we've got hearts and brains and blood systems and stuff. They all work together. And organizations, I have all these different departments, but they all need to work together. And the benefit he described of being in a small business and begin to see how things connect, I think is an interesting observation. He began a story about, you know, supporting the commercial leader. And I thought it was interesting because the closer you are to the customer, the easier it is to measure what's going on. So obviously the customer leader is a place where one tends to focus. But then the story went interesting because he said that person's need wasn't about analysis, it was about a role to do the analysis, about that analytic skill set. And he said, great, I'll bring that person on because I've got a bunch of other tasks for that person to do. And he sort of put that in the category of helping his customers. Yeah, I like the way that story turned out. But the net is there was a need in the company for that analytic capability. And shame on Tony for not seeing that ahead of time, not hearing about it till he had a customer needing it. But good for him for making that leap to say, we now need to, even though it's a small company, we now need to add this competency into the pool. And I understand it has benefits in multiple departments, which is why it makes more sense that Tony took on the person than the commercial leader. So I liked that sort of evolution. I think many organizations go through the same thing, where sometimes the wrong department hires a competency because they need that need met. And where that person should have been wasn't ready to bring them on. And then you end up with a very convoluted organization chart where some analytics are getting done in FP&A, others are getting done in the organization. So there's a sort of a warning sign there as well to be mindful of what the need set is across the corporation and be specific about where you bring in that competency so that it has maximum benefit. Now, that's way more than Tony described, but that's what I sort of extracted from his story.
Yeah, that's an interesting way of looking at it. I mean, we've heard how different leaders, different operational leaders at times will actually make hires of people with finance backgrounds. I mean, it's no surprise that many of these roles intersect both operations and finance, but you know, how that person can be developed further. What's the next rung on the ladder? It seems to me that finance leaders would be the best people who could help that type of talent take the next step within an organization.
Well, there's sort of three issues at play here that impact ultimately the organization chart. So one is the competency pool that you need. And the way that we've traditionally built organization charts is I get people with similar competencies and have them hang out together, sales department versus accounting versus IT. So I'm clustering based on functionality. Then there becomes the locational need. So maybe I need financial support at a branch plant or a branch office. I would physically move that accountant to that different location and maybe even have them report up to the branch manager or the plant manager. And that's where I end up having a difference between the organization chart and the competency chart. Now that person ends up being orphaned to a certain extent, orphaned in that there aren't a bunch of colleagues they can hang out with and ask, how do I do this issue or that issue? Nor, as you point out, is there a clear career path because I'm kind of on a siding. I'm out there at the plant or the branch office. These days, we can solve that problem without changing the organization chart. In other words, if I have a weakness on the financial arm at a branch plant or a branch location, I can bridge that gap with data and OKRs. So I for that accountant, I'd set up objectives for that accountant or that FP&A person around that branch officer manufacturing and make that a shared objective and key result with the branch manager. Now I haven't had to physically move that person. They can still hang out with people with that shared competency so they can compare notes and methodologies and get that standard playbook. But at the same time, I get the expertise focused where I need it focused. So we can solve those problems differently now than how we have historically. In Tony's story is kind of a good example of how we do it if we're not, how we do that hire if we're not thinking it through in a more macro sense. I think it happens less these days, partly because of, you know, the modern work world we've been forced into. So many organizations have made hires these days that aren't in the corporate headquarters city or location. And I never really expected that person to be on site 4 or 5 days a week. So I've begun to make hires where I know they're not going to be on site as we have done historically. So I think the world is changing about how we solve those problems. I don't think it's changing fast enough, but I think it's an inevitable twist to the direction I just described.
I should mention too that I'm aware of that the Institute of Management Accountants have identified this need for certification of individuals that rely outside perhaps the traditional finance function. People who are looking to develop their finance skill sets but who are not part of traditional finance.
Yeah, no, I think that's absolutely the case that, you know, we developed, again, these departmental silos based on a competency sets that were literally kept as a secret. And, you know, accountants had their own secret language and IT had a different secret language. But these days, those lines are blurred. Could you imagine doing accounting without a computer? No, that the line between IT and accounting ain't what it used to be. Or doing accounting without doing analysis through like Power BI or something. No, you can't. So a lot of those skills that we used to cubbyhole in different departments now need to be shared by that individual and become a general pool of knowledge. So that observation, I think, is accurate that everyone needs a bit of accounting experience or knowledge. Everyone needs a bit of IT experience or knowledge. Everyone needs a bit of sales experience or knowledge. And we can get it so much faster now than the old days where you'd, like at GE, you'd do a rotation. You'd be in finance for a year or two. Then you'd be in marketing for a year or two. Then you'd be in accounting for a year. And by the time you're 55 years old, you're finally ready to take on a managerial role.
Well, I am going to introduce our next planning ace, who will be Karen Williams, CFO of American Express Global Business Travel. Now, this is a publicly traded company. I don't know if everybody's aware. Back in May of 2022, following the completion of the business combination with Apollo Strategic Growth Capital, the company began trading on the New York Stock Exchange. Karen is hired roughly around that time as a deputy CFO immediately following the transaction. But within 12 months, I believe she steps into the CFO office. In any case, this is Karen Williams, CFO of Amex Global Business Travel.
Yeah, I mean, clearly, you know, as we think about demand, there's, you know, first off, we look externally in terms of the macros. And so whether that be just understand, because it, you know, that has a big influence. And so as we look at what is going on in terms of GDP, what's happening with inflation, interest rates and such across the various markets, As we think about our industry and those metrics and understanding demand, quite broadly, you know, it's difficult to put your hands on those key metrics. What we have found is every quarter we go out to our top 100 customers and ask them about their plans and how they're feeling, and you know, and that is a really good gauge for us in terms of just real time understanding from those that are, you know, that are really driving it, to get from them. But for me, you know, as we look forward, we're always looking more broadly at what more can we be looking at from, you know, different data sources, because there's so much out there that is available, and how do we look at some lead indicators? And the other piece I would say, just, you know, as I reflect, one of the things from just as we think about this, you know, the metrics for the business, one of the things we are trying to do is drive more and more self-serve to the organization. So it's not just about the metrics, but it's also about the tools. And if you go back 10 years or so, it has changed so much. And so whether it now be Tableau, Power BI, which we use in the organization, of just encouraging people to become numerate, interested in that data, but to self-serve so that we can then spend our time on other things and helping drive performance and value and impact in other areas.
Well, so, you know, a bunch of things about Karen struck me. Now she's a pretty significant CFO. I have no idea how that story unfolded. I would have loved to hear how she made that transition, but it was just an interesting data point. Now, her conversation was interesting because she started off by talking about how she's worried about macro things. And in her line of business, that's clearly the case. Like, you know, business travel's impacted by macro things like COVID or geopolitical uncertainty and so on. So most of us don't need to worry about that big picture stuff. I thought that was interesting. And I was beginning to sort of get myself challenged with how that applies to mere mortals like the rest of us. But then she talked about, you know, how she interviews the top 100 customers once a quarter to get a reading what's going on. And I thought, well, there's a dandy practice. Like, how many of us interview our external customers once a quarter to find out what's on their mind? Because that's actually a lagging indicator in many aspects, but it's a leading indicator if you're not paying attention to it. So if I'm waiting a year before I hear from my customer, I'm going to be way out of phase. If I'm waiting a quarter, I'm going to be less out of phase. Now, I'd prefer it to be near real time, but, you know, I thought that was interesting as a practice. Take your top 100 and just find out what's on their mind. What's interesting is that triggered her to understand that there are, in her world, there's just an abundance of data sources, and they need to stop just relying on what they've used historically and begin using some of these new data sources. Now, my mind immediately went to, gosh, wouldn't it be interesting to take a look at, in her business, global travel, how much people are using, you know, Zoom, Teams, WebEx, and so forth. Obviously, huge spike in 2019 for some reason, probably dwindled down in 2023, I'm going to say, and maybe it's popping back up in 2024. Now, that's new data. That stuff didn't exist, obviously, 5 years ago, but has to be super important if I'm in that global travel industry as an indicator how much people are traveling versus satisfying that need for interaction through other technologies. So, you know, back to that same thing that Tony brought up to begin with, is exploring what does a company need in terms of analytics and what it is that we should be looking at is her new topic.
I thought the emphasis she put on being self-sufficient was interesting.
Which actually relates to the conversation that you and I just had about Tony and competencies is, so I need the competency not only of analytics, the curiosity for looking for new indicators, and the ability to be self-sufficient, to use tools like Power BI to create our own reporting. And I thought that was interesting because, as you and I just talked about, there's no longer this hard division between what we do as accountants or FP&A does and the people that produce the reports that go to leadership, that go to the investors and so on. We've got to do it ourselves. And we actually need those tools to do our job. Most software applications have some reporting capability inside of them. So she was just using examples of tools that they have in their ecosystem.
Yeah.
The broader concept wasn't about the tool specifically. It was about not only the ability to do the analytics, but to be able to communicate those analytics, to create those reports and create those stories. That's no longer left to senior people on the team. Like Karen, she's expecting her team members to be able to carry that burden as well and not to outsource it to some other department.
Well, our last planning ace is Robert Cornella, who we've already mentioned a few items from his background, but he is today CFO of RNDC. I think it's the second largest wine and spirits distributor in the States today. And RNDC stands for a Republic National Distributing Company. So it's in Robert's lane. And by that, I mean, well, I had mentioned earlier that he was at Coca-Cola for 17 years. And that is time that was spent in Europe. And what you're about to hear is he'll relate a chapter about when he steps into the CFO role of Coca-Cola Germany. And it's kind of an interesting story. He was involved in some of the merger and acquisition activity. And at the time, I believe he relates the story that Coca-Cola management team said, well, you know, Robert, you know everybody involved in this. If this is going to work, we need you in the CFO office. And really, that was a big part of his credential. They were merging these different distributors, I believe, beverage distributors in Europe. He had been involved in them. Here is Robert Cornella, CFO of RNDC today, taking a look back for us.
What comes to mind for me, and there are several, but if I had to pick one, it would be my experience when as I was mentioning before, Jack, I was talking a little bit about when I got to Coca-Cola in Germany and I became the CFO. And when I became the CFO, I was a relatively young man at the time. It was my first CFO role. And I had to create a long-range plan now for this bottling entity, this manufacturing entity that had been put together that I had helped kind of build through the M&A side of the business. My role at the time was M&A leading that consolidation. And then all of a sudden I'm handed the keys to the kingdom, so to speak, to be the CFO. And I had to put together a long range plan to say, what does this look like in 3 to 5 years? So you say to yourself, okay, well, how hard can that be? And what I had recognized then in sitting in this new role was that we had so much work to do from an operational perspective to, harmonize our pricing, rebalance some of the value chain economics that were in place at the time, come up with a synergy plan to harvest the synergies and, drive the ROI at that time that the company had invested in these bottlers. So there were a lot more complexities to it than what I thought there would be at that moment in time. So there's a few key insights I learned from that process. It was first, we certainly did all the cleanup along with our bottling partners, our commercial teams. We cleaned up all the price terms and conditions. We can go to our retail partners and speak with one voice of the customer and get a common set of kind of commercial metrics and mechanics. We rebalanced some of the value chain economics to make sure that our franchise bottlers were incentivized to invest for the long term and everyone was making a fair profit so they could invest capital. We really dug into the synergy plan. So put a lot of pieces in place to get the LRP done, presented to our senior management, because at the time that was a lot of money that Coca-Cola had invested. And certainly the board was looking at this very intently, as was Wall Street at the time. So we ultimately got that done, but there was a few things that I took away from that that I would say that I've used in my personal playbook over the years. First, a relatively predictable revenue and profit stream is a good thing in the business. And if you know how your value chain economics are set up, and you have fairness on both sides of the equation within a system, so. In that context, it was Coca-Cola selling concentrate, the bottlers buying the concentrate and selling it on. Having a balanced set of economics where both parties are incentivized and both can reasonably predict what they're going to get in terms of revenue and profit, that's good for a business. It's good for investment, number one. Number two, when you come into a new role, as I did at that time, you know, one of the first things I suggest doing is just understand where the top levers of value are. What drives the economics or the financial ecosystem of that business and the, you know, the system you operate in. So understand your value levers and which ones you have to pull. I would also say standardize, streamline, and scale as quickly as you can. Those are great opportunities for any kind of finance function. Understand when you're presenting to senior management, and you know, at that time I had to go to the Coke CEO and CFO and other members of senior management and present this plan. You have to know what good looks like 3 to 5 years down the road. How do you define what good looks like? I think that's that was an important learning for me to help articulate that, to say, here's the vision, here's how we're going to get there, here's what good looks like. And then last but not least, you know, make sure you surround yourself with the right people on your team that understand your vision, understand also what good looks like as you're building the team. So I was fortunate enough to be in that position. I learned a lot. There was a lot of trial and error on many things, but you know, that helped me in subsequent roles, not only Coca-Cola, but you know, outside of it and RDC as well.
Yes, yeah, certainly he put a nice twist on it, but I'm sure there must be some Yogi Berra quote that, you know, what, you know, be careful what you ask for because you might get it. Like he was involved in all the merger work, and then all of a sudden they said, great, now go make it happen. And I'm sure he went, holy smokes, Batman, I wasn't planning on that happening. You know, to me, he did a great job of doing you're in my job, which is synthesizing what he learned, right? So three lessons. Lesson one is, you know, it's super critical that you've got a predictable revenue stream, that you understand what that mechanics look like. And the double click on that was that it needs to be fair for both sides. So his example was Coca-Cola makes a syrup, the bottler, and I don't know the process, but I'm assuming they take the syrup, add water, put it in a bottle, and away you go. And it needs to be fair for both sides of the deal. And I think we often forget that we try to make the most wealth on our side of the fence without thinking about the person on the other side of the table. So predictable revenue stream, fairness on both sides.
And the emphasis he then placed on the notion that anytime you take on a new role, understand what the value levers are.
So, and I guess he's reflecting on when he was looking at the M&A, it was all about the fair deal. Now he's now trying to run that ecosystem. What are the levers? And then he came out with the quotable quote, which was standardize, streamline, and scale.
You know, when I heard him say it this time, I was like, well, that's the name of our episode. What do you think?
That makes sense. Standardize is obviously get the processes so that they're done in a repeatable, reliable way over time. And that's part of what Tony's story was with hiring this new person. And that's part of what Karen's story was in terms of, you know, being curious to find the new analytics and data that you need to look at. And then streamline, that's what Karen was talking about in terms of using reporting tools to streamline the process. So I'm not going to external people to create those reports and so on. And then those two things allow you to scale, to repeat that in a broader and broader context. And that's where Karen's at as she begins going to small businesses. Like once I've got those system standardized and streamlined, I can cost effectively hit smaller organizations and give them things that before only large corporations can get. So I thought that second learning was applicable to everyone. Standardized, streamlined, scale. That's what we need to be doing and mindful of on an ongoing basis.
He also said, know what good looks like 2 to 3 years out.
And you know, that's important for all of them. I often think of, for example, Amazon, right? When Amazon first popped out, it was just a bookstore. And you go, well, you know, limited opportunity in that business. Look at it now. Well, what did good look like in 3 to 5 years? Or probably good looked like more than selling just books. Step one, build that retail engine. Step two, move to other products. So what does good look like? And all three of them told that story. Like, Karen's talking about, what are those macro trends and staying on top of them. And Robert took that head on. So I thought that was an important lesson. Then the third lesson, which is surround yourself with the right people, is also a universal truth. And all three of our candidates this week talked about that aspect. How do I make the right hire? How do I make sure they got the right competencies? How do I give them the right challenges? How do I develop the people? So we've heard that theme before, but I think Robert did just a great job of encapsulating those three learnings as something that we can all apply.
Nice. Good place to end our episode, Brett. I mentioned I have a train to catch before the holiday.
Okay, well, have yourself a fun trip.
For Planning Aces, this is Jack Sweeney with Brett Knowles, wishing everybody safe travels this holiday weekend. And as always, thank you for listening.